Hello, all. Welcome back to Geezerology. Bill's going to start a new series today. We're going to call it Small Labels, Big Noise. And Bill is essentially going to go through a few record labels. I call them boutique labels, but you know, they were small, mostly independent companies that ended up having a pretty good impact on the music industry during their peak years. And Bill is a fan of these things, and he wanted to kind of go through a few of these. And today he's going to start off telling you about Stiff Records. Take it away, Bill.
Thanks, Scott. Stiff Records is well regarded historically because it really doesn't exist as an entity of any importance now, but historically is a critical component of the punk explosion in the UK in the late 70s. And the whole thing about this is that, you know, at the time, the record business was dominated by major labels, those conglomerates that really had their fingers in all kinds of styles and genres around the world. And, they had their own approach, marketing arms, development of musicians and artists and repertoire people, and folks who helped with the art, the marketing, all of the logistics of touring and that sort of stuff. And it was great if you were on the inside and you were picked up by one of those labels because they saw something in your capability. But it could be really difficult if you were different or were not necessarily something that would slot easily into a major label's idea of what could be sold to the populace at large. And again, the idea was this is, music for mass consumption. So difficult time, difficult space if you were not one of those kinds of artists. At this time in the UK, there were, a number of different things going on. There was the heavy rock, glam rock, all kinds of middling pop stuff. The big bands of the 60s had either broken up or were kind of coasting. There was always a scene going on one way or another, one place or another. And pub rock was one of those places where things were percolating. And pub rock is kind of an elastic term, but it was, as the term sounds, it bands that were, they played in bars essentially, and they came up with, their own material that they actually mixed in with covers, and some of them were well regarded, some of them were not, but they were, there were enough of them with enough interesting characters around that things started to at least be able to break out of just those bars and maybe get into the either the music papers where the coverage might lead to something, or perhaps somebody might be able to get into a record studio and cut something. But how would that happen? How could that happen if the majors didn't care? Well, a couple of these bands had people involved who had been around the music business long enough and had thought about what it might take to capitalize on this in the space where they actually were familiar with artists, that they thought if we get a little bit of money together, maybe we can do this ourselves. And these two guys that founded Stiff Records, Jake Rivera and Dave Robinson, both had those pub rock backgrounds. Dave Robinson, at one time was even a roadie for Jimi Hendrix. Jake Rivera had a lot of management experience with these kind of sub-tier bands, Chili Willy and the Red Hot Peppers, and these kind of other outfits. We have talked in the past about the late Wilco Johnson and Dr. Feelgood. He was involved with them as well, and he could try to put packages together and make some things happen. But if you had a record label, and that's what Dave Robinson and Jake Rivera wanted to do, maybe we could actually, they thought, get something happening. So they pooled some money, it wasn't very much, but it was enough to establish a label, which they called Stiff Records. And this is where the genius actually was. The idea that you would take what a stiff was, which is a record that didn't make the charts, and actually use that as the name of your label itself, you know, was kind of contrary, but it made sense. Even in retrospect, even more sense, because the times were changing enough that out of this pub rock came enough talent that was a little squirrely and a little bit oddball that would, you know, kind of be signed to a record label like Stiff Records. And these people kind of included Graham Parker, The Damned, Nick Lowe, Dave Edmonds, Elvis Costello, Lena Lovitch, Madness. There's a whole kind of roll call of talent that went on to become better or lesser known, but it's, you know, certainly in the era from 76 when the label was founded to about 1980, a lot of talent that these two guys had discovered and then signed and marketed. And the marketing was, you know, partially the genius that really helped them raise visibility. So the talent of the artists was varied, but good. I mean, Ian Drury and the Blockheads had been gigging around for a number of years, but with Stiff behind them, they actually were able to, you know, have a whole marketing campaign that was also predicated on graphic design work by a guy named Barney Bubbles. That was his name de guerre. And he was a very clever guy who was able to really give a lot of these groups a very distinct graphic personality. So with marketing notions like, if it ain't stiff, it ain't worth a fuck, or we came, we saw, we left. These are all of the kind of approaches that Stiff took, putting a lot of their artists together on package tours. So you might end up seeing, you know, very similar to the late 50s, early 60s thing, where you'd get a number of bands that would play at a venue over the course of an evening. You'd get Reckless Eric, you'd get Rachel Sweet, Elvis, and, you know, maybe Ian Drury, maybe Nick Lowe and Dave Edmonds together. This is before the Rock Pile, you know, got together as an official outfit. So the takeaway for this was that a lot of this was really enough of a kind of a sub-tier label making noise that people in the majors started to pay attention. And when, you know, The Damned, which released the first punk record, essentially, New Rose on Stiff Records, you know, actually got some pickup, the majors started to pay attention. And because of that, they started to cherry pick those same kind of venues where Jake Rivera and Dave Robinson were finding talent. And as typically is the case with, you know, things that are kind of slapdash, there were problems with Stiff in particular. After a while, I think Rivera and Robinson didn't get along. Rivera left. He took Elvis Costello with him, which essentially hamstrung the whole outfit, because Elvis, by this point, along with Ian Drury, were kind of the leaders in the sales department. And that, you know, led to the slow disintegration of the outfit. But over the course of the years, you know, what they released or what they issued, including Richard Hell and the Voidoids, the Pogues, other bands that, you know, made a significant mark, if not in the US, at least in the UK, you know, it was very, very influential. The key thing to me as a kid buying records was that if I saw a Stiff Records label on something that I was not familiar with, I would pretty much be assured that I was not wasting my money on it. It was worth checking out. And very rarely, although I was disappointed sometimes, very rarely was I terribly disappointed. I mean, one of the guys that seemed to have a lot of talent but never really wanted to develop it, Mickey Jupp, was a guy that I found on Stiff on stiff records. And it was important because the records that I'm buying here, we're talking about singles primarily and some LPs, were imports. So they were expensive. And you have to make your money count. I give Stiff Records a lot of credit for kind of cultivating my own sense of looking at labels as a place where you could, if they were at the independent level, could help, guide and develop your own levels of taste. So that's Stiff Records. Check them out. They're still around releasing stuff, although it's, essentially a licensed name that's used by some other conglomerate as happens.
Yeah, it is now owned by Universal Music Group, revived in like 2007 or something like that. But Stiff Records, yeah, its lifetime was essentially from 1976 to 1986. A lot of people that you remember and remember fondly came from Stiff Records. So I just checked their website, and their website is actually a Facebook page. So if you're not on Facebook, you can't get to their websites. But there's a good Wikipedia article on it, so look into it. And we'll provide you during the course of this video with some of the artists that were there that you probably remember a lot of them. Okay, Bill. Well, thanks for that. And Bill will be back sometime soon with a look at another label. And we look forward to doing that. We'll talk to you later. So long. So it goes, so it goes, so it goes, so it goes.